Welcome to the podcast. You are listening to First Impressions, a podcast by two Jane Austen fans, which is a safe space for us to discuss our love for Jane Austen and her novels. And we can give a big middle finger to all the haters who try to make us feel, bad about liking Jane Austen. I'm Maggie, and I am joined, as always, by my brilliant friend, Kristen.
Hello.
She is the creator of this podcast. She's the one who has all the smart things to say.
Not true.
Okay, well, we'll see.
You say that, but I know it's not true. The both of you are smart.
Well, thank you. That voice you're hearing is our special guest on today's episode, which we will get into in a little while. But let's just quickly recap where we are in our podcast. This is our third podcast about the novel Emma. In our previous two podcasts, we talked about the characters, how it's Jane Austen's considered her masterpiece. And we talked about, in general, some of the themes that are prevalent in the book. So in this episode, we're doing things a little differently. We're joined by a very special guest. And I'll throw it over to Kristen to do an introduction.
Oh, wow. Okay. So our very special guest is Arnie Perlstein. And Arnie is a dear personal friend of mine. Way back in the day when I first got serious about learning more about Jane Austen, I joined the Austen L listserv, which is hosted at McGill University. And I was immediately plunged into a world of academic discussion about Austen and facts about her life and details about her life that I didn't know, and context about the things that she read. And I think the most interesting and unique voice on Austen L listserv, in my opinion, was Arnie Perlstein. And he would send emails to the group that were so insightful and so well-researched and also so challenging that I was really drawn into his theories. And long story short, Arnie and I struck up a friendship, and he introduced me to the concept of a shadow story, which is something that he's going to talk about at length today.
Which is, it's an intriguing idea.
Intriguing idea.
So some of you will probably hear about the shadow stories and kind of roll your eyes and be like, this is ridiculous. But I think there, if you can really dig into the text, there are some really interesting things to discover in the novels. So before we get into that though, Arnie, why don't we talk a little bit about your background and how you came to discover Jane Austen?
Okay, well, first of all, I want to express my great pleasure to be here talking to you, and very excited about hoping that all kinds of interesting and unexpected things will happen for all of us in the course of the time we're speaking.
Well, I hope so too. It's always unexpected when we all get together.
Well, that should be a line from a Jane Austen novel, right? So anyway, how I came to Jane Austen actually was pretty late in the day for me. I'm now 63.
So in
August, I'm going to get to finally sing off key when I'm 64.
Okay, but you look great.
Thank you.
Same. So if you're watching the YouTube hangouts of this, you know that Arnie looks great.
Keep talking. When I got married for the last time in 1995, my wife, we'll let that pass what that means, but when I married my wife, Jackie, which was 21 years ago, one of the first things that we did together is that she took me to see the Emma Thompson Sense and Sensibility. And at that moment, I was 42 years old, had no prior acquaintance with Jane Austen whatsoever. Mm-hmm. I might have been able to identify Pride and Prejudice as a title and maybe knew that she was the author, but I knew nothing about her, had never read it. I was not an English major in college. In fact, I avoided reading fiction for many years when I was an adult and raising a family, whatever. I just got caught up in other things and just never got back to my teenage love of literature. Are you guys still there?
Yeah, we're still here.
Okay.
We're just listening.
All right. Okay. And so when we went to see Sense and Sensibility, my wife, who had been an English minor and is also a psychologist and a brilliant, brilliant person, we came out of the movie theater and she said, well, what do you think? And I said, well, it's a great movie and a great story, which is hardly a shocker to say that about the Emma Thompson Ang Lee version. I said, but the only thing that bothered me a little was there's this kind of obsession with how people speak, you know, this sort of focus on saying it the right way and being a gentleman. I said, I found that a little irritating. Well, of course, in hindsight, I now say to my wife, well, you had a project here. because you didn't like the fact that I would tend to speak without reflection beforehand, and maybe I wasn't saying things in quite the most genteel way.
Oh, I can definitely relate to that criticism, speaking without reflection.
No, you
must be kidding. That is not something that I am not familiar with.
Exactly.
So you saw the film, and then did you decide to dig into the books at that point?
Well, the next step was what I think was a real common portal for many people who are now Janeites, which is that like a year later came out the Andrew Davis Pride and Prejudice, you know, the one with Colin Firth and Jennifer Ailey, which is the Pride and Prejudice. Even though the BBC is good, the old BBC is good, but it's much stiffer and less formal, and I can't get on board with the Keira Knightley.
At some point, we have to have a discussion, not in this episode, about Kristen's loathing for that movie, especially Donald Sutherland.
Yes.
Oh. She hates Donald Sutherland. Crazy. I mean, I don't like him for other reasons having to do with Buffy, the Vampire Slayer.
Yes,
But we will revisit this topic at some
point. Fair enough.
Sidebar, super fast sidebar. We were in the UK at Chawton Cottage, where Austen lived. There was a man there who was like an interpreter, right? Mm-hmm. He asked me, did you see that 2005, you know, Pride and Prejudice? And I said, yes. He goes, what'd you think? And I go, I hated it. And he goes, well, I was an advisor on that movie.
Oh, thank you very much.
It was this amazing, awkward moment.
Well, he deserved it. He should get a lot of awkward moments for perpetrating.
Well, I always tell people that this is now we're getting totally on tangent. I always tell people that if you need, this was before Northanger Abbey came out as a movie. If you needed a quick Austen fix in a movie, that was not an awful way to do it. Like if you just, I really feel like I need some Jane Austen. Now I tell people just to watch Northanger Abbey.
Right.
That's a good choice. So anyway, that's when we watched that on TV along with how many million other viewers, that's when I got the impulse to read Jane Austen. So I can't remember exactly, but I know it was very shortly after that I actually picked up a copy somewhere and started reading it and was really taken with it. And then over the course of a couple of years, I read Sense and Sensibility because I had seen the movie, and read Emma, found Emma very opaque, very hard to get into, but I had already seen the Gwyneth Paltrow and the Kate Beckinsale versions by then, so I knew the story, but the novel disappointed me because I felt sort of disconnected from what was happening. And I tried Mansfield Park and didn't really enjoy it, and I never even read Northanger Abbey at that point. And what am I leaving out? I think, Persuasion. Oh, and we saw the wonderful Persuasion with Amanda Root and whatever his name is. Charon Hines. And so the key point, though, that changed everything for me with Jane Austen is when one day I decided, because I was one of the early adopters in the late 90s of talking with people online about anything. You know, I joined various online discussion groups. So one day in like 2000, I said, gee, there must be a group to talk about Jane Austen with. And it happened, of course, because of the Colin Firth, Jennifer Ailey version, there were a zillion people wanting to talk about Jane Austen a couple of years later. And so when I entered the Janeites group, which I'm still a member of, which is the alternative in English language to the Austen L group, there were like 50 people actively talking and like hundreds of others lurking behind and occasionally. So it was a mob scene, a virtual mob scene. And what was remarkable is that we were doing, it was all so fresh and nobody had really spent a lot of time talking to each other for more than a year or two. So we do these group reads. And what happened is one day I started to participate in them and I was amazed at how stimulating it was to my imagination to argue about Jane Austen with other people. I don't know if you've had that experience. Yeah.
What I love about your story is I think that a lot of people in this country can relate to that. Because my first discovered Austen, we talked about this in our first episode a bit, was also with the 1995 miniseries. I remember watching it with my mom, and I was 15. I had never read Jane Austen. Maybe we hadn't gotten to her in school yet. Yeah. I don't know. But that was how I discovered it too. And I don't think your story is that unusual.
No, it's not.
For people. It seems to be like that. And I just finished reading actually part of a book that we talked about, Jane Austen in Hollywood, which talks about the huge influx of interest in her work in the 1990s when all of these film adaptations were coming out.
You know what, the one that really started it, and I didn't see it at the time, but I saw it later, was Clueless. Clueless was the earliest of the wave, and it actually ignited something that caused the others to be made, I think.
Because people were saying, oh, this is really, oh, you know, it's based on the novel Emma. Mm-hmm. You're like, oh, really? I don't think I've heard of that. And then it just kind of spiraled from there.
As much as I like to think about the books as so easy to pick up and read, because they are for me, I do sometimes have to stop and reflect that they were written over 200 years ago. And a lot of people need an interpreter. Mm-hmm. They need that first movie to interpret it for them and to show them. And then once they pick up the book, they're willing to deal with the opaque language as you described it, I think.
Yeah, I think this is something that we've touched on too, about how we'll say to a modern reader, this might seem strange, or sometimes the language can be a bit inaccessible for someone who's used to a more modern novel. But I think we all kind of have similar stories.
Yeah.
Yeah, but Arnie.
Because I'm an obsessive personality.
Once you found the Jane Austen community, so then why don't you tell us about shadow stories?
Yes. Well, define a shadow story for us.
Okay, a shadow story, the best example I can give is think of the thing we've all seen. There are these figure ground images that you see, you know, in books or online, where it looks like a vase. And then if you look at it again, you see it's two faces facing each other. And it seems like these two images go back and forth in your brain. And it's, you don't see both at the same time. You either see one or the other. And which one you see first, I don't know if they've ever studied to see which one is more likely. But there are different versions of it. Well, now imagine that a writer of a novel could be so creative as to find a way in a novel to do something analogous to what that painter or that image creator, visual image creator, did with that thing. And there's also a famous painting going back to the Renaissance by Holbein called The Ambassadors, which if you can look it up online, The Ambassadors by Holbein, you've got these two people standing there in medieval garb, and then beneath their feet, there's like this blurry image of something gray.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about. We studied this in my high school AP European. This is the skull. Is that what you're talking about?
Yep, yep.
If you like turn your head a certain
way. No, you have to be standing to the left of the picture at a certain moment. You see the skull exactly as it was originally existing. Well, imagine someone does that in a novel. How do you do that? Well, I'm giving all this to you from the back end of the telescope, because I figured all this out over a period of years, which I'm now telling you as though I knew it all along. No, I didn't. What happened is I saw my first pieces of these alternative ways of reading pieces of the novel bit by bit. Like the first one I saw, which I've told 1,000 times, is in the scene early in Sense and Sensibility when Marianne goes out with her sister to run in the rain and she falls down and twists her ankle on the hill, and then Willoughby swoops in and rescues her and romance ensues, blah, blah, blah. This was like my third or fourth reading of Sense and Sensibility in a group read on Jainites. And suddenly the idea pops into my head, he was stalking her, which is a weird thing to think. And
so, do you think it's fair to say that a lot of the things that readers in one of the novels would say, what a coincidence? You know, what a coincidence that Willoughby happened to be on the hill at the same time. What a coincidence that Frank Churchill's aunt dies at this convenient time. So many of the things that we as readers initially would interpret as a fortunate, a lucky coincidence, you interpret as an evidence of the shadow plot. Something else is happening to create that circumstance.
Well, let me give you a quick aside there. The biggest coincidence I'm aware of in all of Jane Austen is actually the one in her most popular and most famous novel, which is Pride and Prejudice. Why is it, which is never explained or even mentioned by the narrator or noticed by Elizabeth, who is, in my opinion, utterly clueless when you look at her from a certain perspective. She's more clueless than Emma. It never occurs to her. It's weird that Wickham, Darcy, Mr. Collins, Gardner, they're all connected. And there's this country town, Meryton.
Yeah, they all end up in Meryton.
One family at Longbourn. All of a sudden, all these people converge on her like with metal filings to a magnet. Mm-hmm. Why? Now, you can either say that Jane Austen was expedient, that she wanted to create a story that would play out like dominoes falling at the end, which is exactly what happens. That's what's so amazing about the denouement of the plot, is it goes bang, 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 and one thing triggers another in this amazing cascade in a few chapters. It could only happen because of all these dense connections that existed before the story began. But she never tells you that this happened. She never explains it. Now, you can either take that as, which is what most Janeites do when I've ever raised this, they say, oh, she had to do it. It was convenient.
Yeah. Oh, so this is like, well, why does this have to happen? And then, you know, when we talk about the, what we talked about one of our episodes before, you were talking about the angry Jezebel commenter. So I was saying the writing monkeys who just type out, well, why did that happen? Because it had to happen for the plot. And you could make that a criticism, I think, of Jane Austen's novels. Too.
I always rationalize.
The coincidences, the plot.
The coincidence. I mean, life is strange. I always rationalize that by thinking that first of all, the population of Britain was smaller. The number of people who were actually rich enough to be in the sphere of what mm-hmm. we're talking about were
everybody.
Much
it was like a high school. Everybody
it was a high
knew
school.
Everybody.
It was a smaller world, and so that's the way I rationalized
but
it.
What
but
what I
realize, but you realize that's ridiculous.
Yeah.
That if you actually calculate the odds, it's like one in a million that all four of them. A quadruple coincidence is like 16 times as unlikely as a single coincidence.
But this is why I find the idea of shadow stories fascinating from you, because we're you could have a criticism of Austen. Well, it's a cheap out. Like in Northanger Abbey, when his sister, like the man she's
married,
he like suddenly inherits, and now she can marry him, and isn't that great?
Isn't it great?
So these things that you could level as criticisms, as well, it's a deus ex machina, like it had to happen. You attribute to Austen. Kristen just full on put her arm in front of my face.
I attribute
to get a wine refill. She just reached right across my face.
We have our priorities here.
Bay is
we're just very comfortable with each other. That's
so our producer Bay today is the barman, the wine boy refiller. What I was saying. So what someone would attribute to coincidence or to a maybe like a cheapness on the side of the writing, you attribute to Austen's genius in creating these shadow stories.
She's having her cake,
purposeful.
She's having her cake and eating it too. Because in order to, with Holbein, all he had to do to create that ambiguous skull was to sort of set up a mirror somewhere and then to paint while he's looking in the mirror. And that's how, we know that's how he did it.
I think it looks like an oar in the painting too. They had it up on his phone. I actually have a print of that at home because I love that painting so much.
It's really dramatic. But so my premise, now I think we've had enough of banter to get to the heart of what I say a shadow story is.
There's never enough banter.
that each novel, not just Emma, not just mm-hmm. Pride and Prejudice that we've been talking about, but each of the six novels is anamorphic. It has two versions of the story. One of them, which I have called the overt story for obvious reasons, because it's overt, it's what the text sort of leads you to naturally read when you're not asking these suspicious questions, when you're not reading against the grain, when you're reading with the flow, which of course with an incredible writer like Jane Austen, what pleasure there is in reading with the flow and being swept up in her words and her genius and her ideas and just going where it seems to be taking you. That's why this is what everybody has seen for 200 years, is a version of the story that goes this way. But I learned, I think via the good luck of living in the modern era when we had computers, when we had internet discussion groups, when we had movies, all this sort of convergence of tools, sort of, and then me, who was an obsessive crossword puzzle kind of person. If you ever, did you see the movie The Imitation Game?
I actually just
saw it. Did you see it, Kristen?
No, I didn't.
Oh, I don't want to spoil it for you, but it's about Alan Turing, the guy
Correct,
who...
Correct, with Benedict Cumberbatch.
Yeah, yes. Fun fact, Bay and I saw that movie on our third date or something like that.
How romantic.
Yeah, it was totally...
I hope it was more romantic than Alan Turing was in the movie. but be that as it may, notice how they, and actually I checked on this, and there's some historical validity to not, maybe not he, but the people who ran that program, they found code breakers were people who were really fast at doing crossword puzzles.
Right.
And the British cryptic crossword puzzles are harder than ours, or at least they're harder to me than the New York Times puzzle, which I've been doing for decades. But and I think there is something to that as to why I'm the person who finally had this crazy idea about Willoughby stalking Marianne and then other things of this kind and the coincidences and everything, because crossword puzzles train you to think suspiciously. Because a really good crossword puzzle by Will Shortz and his collaborators, there's an obvious answer, and then but that won't work in the Saturday and the Friday and the Thursday puzzle. It works in the Monday puzzle perfectly. You can do the Monday puzzle just taking what is there on the surface, but you can't solve the hard puzzles unless you can step outside the normal frame of reference and look at it from the side.
It's and all about so, the wordplay, which if you've seen that movie, is also fantastic.
I have, and I was at the crossword puzzle tournament after that. I went for fun. It was amazing. It was really fun. I got to talk to like the people who won and everything, these 21-year-old guys who can do the puzzle in 2 minutes that I think I'm a hero because I can do it in 12 minutes, and the ordinary person can't do it.
Yeah, I can't
but, do you know, it's like I just was fascinated on how they could develop this facility at such a young age to do this. But anyway. That's why it was me. It's not that I am some kind of phenomenal genius. I'm just a smart person who loves to solve puzzles, and I came at the right place in the right time. Plus, I had about 20,000 hours over the last 12 years to spend time doing this, because you can't see the big picture that I am going to lay out for you in the remainder of this talk unless you spend an enormous amount of time looking at all of her novels and all the biography and all the scholarly literature, and I've researched everything. Because you get a piece of the puzzle, of the jigsaw puzzle, from every direction. And I've been collecting them for 13 years.
So, Kristen, you want to say something?
I was going to say, this is a good time to pivot and to start talking about the particular shadow story of Emma.
Yes.
So you mentioned that the overt story is the objective story. And one of the things I also like about your theory is that the shadow story comes when we view it from recognizing that the books are told from a subjective point of view, most of them. From, for example, in Emma, it's mostly Emma's point of view. And the thing that I like about this is that I love books that have unreliable narrators. Gone Girl is a good example of that, you know, classic. Yes. You think it's going one way, and then all of a sudden you realize the narrator's been lying the whole time or doesn't know what's going on.
Exactly.
And so your theory is that Emma is very unreliable as a narrator.
But I want to emphasize, it's all six of the novels, and it's not just mostly, it's like 99% by percentages. It's like in every novel, there's a couple of scenes and just pieces of scenes, not whole chapters even, but pieces, where for a brief window, you're in Knightley's mind near the end of Emma, or you're in Darcy's mind for couple of paragraphs or something like that. And every novel, and you're in Charlotte Lucas's mind in Pride and Prejudice for a little bit here and there. And these are clearly things that are being reported to you that the heroine couldn't know. But everything else, all the other scenes, the 99% of what you're reading has narrative that can either be read, as you've been correctly responding, can either be read as a pretty objective, honest, and complete narrative description of what's going on, so that by the time you're done reading each of these scenes, you don't believe you've been had something left out. Or they can be so heavily colored and influenced by the thinking of the heroine, even though it's not written in a first person thing, it's third person, but it's like first person. And if you read it that way, then everything's up for grabs as to whether the person who seems to be happy or sad or angry or deceitful really is, or it's just the heroine thinks here she is.
So what do you think is the main, because I know there are multiple things going on. So what is the main shadow story of Emma?
Okay.
All right, everybody, settle in.
Yes.
Here it comes.
Open your mind. Settle in.
Well, I've given this talk actually to a number of Jane Austen's Society of North America groups, and I also gave one, you mentioned Chawton House. I've given this talk at Chawton House in 2009, and also at Oxford in 2007. I was fortunate to find an Oxford professor with a very open mind who was willing to entertain my, give me a forum before I had even fully fleshed out my ideas anywhere close to where they are now. But it was really wonderful to get that kind of personal feedback and to be there. So what I've said in my Emma talk, which is the one I've given more than any about any other novel, is that the shadow heroine is Jane Fairfax. She is the person around whom everything in the shadow story is, all the bees are buzzing around her. In the overt story, Emma, the ultimate 21-year-old rich narcissist, everything rotates around her. So she's reading. Now, in the objective story, it does rotate around her. She's not crazy. Everybody is oriented to her more or less the way we find out, with her mistakes that are revealed. But basically, at the end of the novel, she has a pretty good idea of what has happened. In the shadow story, where Jane, remember, Jane barely says 10 lines in the whole
thing. I don't feel well. I think I'm going to just walk home.
Right. Only in the chapter where they talk about, they have the discussion about the post office, does she say a lot of stuff. Other than that,
or she's basically saying, like, no, I want to go check my mail.
Right. Leave me the hell alone.
Yeah, could I please just go check my own mail? Is that right. Okay?
But aside from that scene, she has minimal dialogue. And yet at the same time, the novel is constantly, because Emma is obsessed with Jane, so are we. Mm-hmm. We're like little creatures sitting on Emma's shoulder saying, yeah, I want to know too. What's this? And whatever. And while it's hard for us to go back to the moment when we first read Emma, and I actually saw the movie before I read the novel, so I didn't have a chance to sort of have a completely fresh approach to the novel to see what I would have seen. But everybody basically comes away being as curious about Jane as possible. And yet at the end, we get this sudden revelation that she's been involved with Frank all along, and then somehow that's the end of the novel.
And let me interject here too, not to get ahead of ourselves, but the way that I got into this shadow, I was educated about the shadow stories. I wrote to Arnie and I asked him, why Jane? As you know, the author's name is Jane Austen. To be an author and name a character with your own first name, and she does it also with Jane Bennett, but I don't want to get away from ourselves. So. Right. They fetishize the name of Jane Fairfax. If you've read Emma,
it's like Veronica Mars.
Yes, it's like Veronica Mars. Jane Fairfax. It's not Miss Fairfax. So often it's Jane Fairfax that it's that to the point where it sometimes gets on my nerves. And I think she meant it to obtrude on your notice.
Emma is always, Jane Fairfax is always on Emma's nerves, right?
But that's
right. Knightley likes her, and everyone, Jane Fairfax, blah, blah.
It's not just the how much she comes up, it's also the repetition of her first and last name, too.
Yeah. I do need to ask, though, how popular a name was Jane at the time?
It may have been a very popular name, but notwithstanding that, Kristen is 1,000% correct.
I would never name a character in a book Margaret.
Yeah, I'm just saying. Kristen.
Well, for future reference, we'll remember that. Okay. Kristen has had a good instinct to get upon this thing about Jane Austen's methodology. You've just hit on something. What I have found 1,000 times scattered over the 6 novels is that she will emphasize things sometimes, you know, seemingly without meaning, like this one. In other ways, she will constantly emphasize words or key, what I call them, keywords or names or things like that, in ways that seem too overdone or to the point of being irritating. This is her way of drawing your subconscious attention to these details to make you at a certain point do what Kristen did, which is to say, what's up with that? What does this mean? That is you've opened a door into the shadow story. The minute you did that, you had the potential.
Kristen, you opened the door. You found it.
You didn't know there was a door there. No, but you did know because it bothered you enough to ask me. So it was on your mind. But you see, there's a myth of Jane Austen that has been perpetuated. That is goes back to the moment she was, you know, laid beneath Winchester Cathedral, where her family and then other people commenting about her have been presenting this image of her that is a global picture. It's not just one characteristic. It's that she's a pious Anglican. It's that she's humble. It's that she would never have sex, talk about sex. It's that she had no aspirations to be famous. I mean, I could go on and on, but that's all this BS about her
that
has been hardwired into the psyche. So why would I or you or anybody else who comes to Jane Austen, if we read biographies, if we read critical literature, this myth is perpetuated on a daily basis. It's go to Twitter, you find it on a minute-by-minute basis.
I wonder how much of that, her like piety and not talking about sex and stuff like that, is because she was a woman of that time. Because when I read her books, I certainly don't think that. Anyone who is capable of such amazing insight into the human character and cleverness and genius, it seems to me, must know. I mean, obviously she doesn't know much of the world because she didn't really go anywhere, but I agree with you. I think that's ridiculous.
It's not ridiculous.
I think it has, the only thing I can think of, it's because she's a woman, right?
Yeah.
Because she was a female author at that time, especially.
Right. I mean, she even published Sense and Sensibility under the author name, A Lady.
Right.
Because she, even that was like almost too much. And that was, you know, it's so tame to go that way.
I read it a long time ago and I don't remember it, but the novel by Nafisi about reading Lolita in Tehran, where she, have you read that or heard about it? And she talks about reading Pride and Prejudice with her little secret group while they're doing this. Jane Austen was living in a country like that 200 years ago. Women were, especially a smart woman with a big mouth and brilliant, who was smarter than everyone else in the room, Hillary Clinton, you know, look at the stuff that's happening with Hillary, because she's a woman, and you as women can tell that there, you know, that men don't really get, that she doesn't get a certain level of respect because she's a woman, right?
Yeah, well, that's kind of the point of our podcast.
Yeah, that's the entire point of our podcast.
Yeah, that we're just sick of people. She's a female writer, so she must write frivolous things about like just romance novels. And I mean, that's the whole mission statement.
You wouldn't believe the things that people have said to me.
But Jane Austen partly created this because, in a way, she's like.
But she had to, right?
She had to, but she also was trying to teach us. This I often get into her didactic motivation that I perceive, which is that why would a writer, aside from the fact that it's really fun as an artistic aesthetic thing to create a double story, she also wanted to create the ambiguity that we all face in our daily life. When you walk around, even right now, you don't know me. You don't know what really motivates me, what makes me tick.
Oh, I know you, Arnie.
I hope you don't know me.
I hope you're wagging your finger.
like Bernie Sanders wagging.
I don't mean to interrupt, but we have to think of our listeners here, because I was being a little unfair because I already know the Shadow story, and you were starting to talk about what.
We totally got off track.
Yeah,
Can I just say one more thing?
Yes.
I love what you were saying about her being so clever and having a big mouth, because I just think, if we could go out with Jane Austen now, like go to a bar with her, she would be so fun, right?
Oh, beyond.
She would be so fun to hang out with.
She would be, just imagine a contemporary figure, who, I'm trying to think, like Sarah Silverman or Amy Schumer or someone like that. But she would be much better than they are.
She was almost born 200 years too early, right?
Or you could say that it took 200 years for these secret messages that she planted in everybody's minds to finally sprout. And I think that's not a crazy thing to say.
Okay, so back on topic.
Yeah. Emma,
speaking of secret messages, please. Yeah. Okay, Jane Fairfax is the sun, and everyone else actually revolves around. And
only Emma's too clueless to know that.
Emma's the Earth and thinks that the sun revolves around her.
Now I'm going to lead you on a little bit of a garden path here to see what you can, and you may know some of this already from reading some of my stuff or about me, but whatever. But play along.
Okay.
And people
we'll play dumb. It's not going to be hard.
Come on. So what could be a reason? Jane shows up at the very beginning of the second trimester, the second book. The novel came out in three volumes originally, which were 18, 18, and 19 chapters. Almost exactly, symmetrical. Jane shows up at the beginning of chapter 19. Actually, she doesn't show up. We start hearing about her, and something is alarming you here.
Oh, we're out of wine. This is awful. The bottle's empty.
Get these ladies more wine.
Okay, but don't show your face.
It's in the door.
He has to remain mysterious.
We won't look.
He's going to be walking behind me now. Nobody look. You can look at his butt because it's good.
Okay. I'm not going to look at his butt, but anyway.
Okay, I'm sorry. We were freaking out because I asked him for more and there wasn't.
Okay, so what could be a reason why this young woman who, remember Jane's history, she's been living in London for a number of years. She was at some age, we're not sure exactly how old she was. I think it may have been 8. I'm not sure if we're even told. She's sent to live, because she's an orphan, she's sent to live with this kindly soldier friend of her deceased father, Colonel Campbell, who keeps her in high style in London, where she lives in his home and is best friends with their daughter, young Miss Campbell, right? For some reason, she writes a letter to her aunt, Miss Bates, and then suddenly there is Jane showing up in town, and she's not well physically, right? She's a little bit under the weather.
She's sickly.
She's sickly, or that's what Emma thinks, that she's
sickly. A low constitution modifier.
And then she proceeds to sort of be very mysterious and hanging out away from Emma. Emma wants to ask her a lot of nosy questions. She's ducking all the questions very artfully, better than any politician could in the race today when they don't want to talk about something. And so it's getting Emma more and more in a frenzy to figure out what's going on. Then Frank sort of becomes like, Milton's Satan whispering in Emma's ear saying, maybe it's that, it's all this different stuff. Now, my question to you is, what could be a reason why such a young woman, who's a single woman, would appear in the town of her birth and then hide out for what turns out to be 6 months, and then suddenly in the end gets married to this guy? And what could be a reason, if you were very suspicious, for why she could be feeling really bad about 3 months into her the story of the novel, the timeline?
Okay, let's see, Kristen, what is a reason why a single woman in a certain time period would leave her home for a period of about 6 months to stay with distant relatives and be sick all the time?
Because she has got a bun in the oven.
She got knocked up.
You got it, which is, by the way, why Miss Bates talks a lot about baking. What is it she talks about baking? It's like you bake the thing three times over, ridiculous. Baking the apples, there's your bun in the oven right there.
So Miss Bates knows, right?
Of course Miss Bates knows. She's protecting her.
Does Mrs. Bates know?
Who knows, but it probably.
She doesn't talk at all.
We have to ask about the belly, though. I mean, I know there's that show we know.
Well, they have those high empire waists.
You're getting ahead, because you have to see that the novel is exactly corresponding with the three trimesters of her pregnancy, of her concealed pregnancy. It's exactly corresponding. You know, at the end of chapter 36, she's 6 months in. All right, so now the next question you should be asking, because let's get right to it. If she's pregnant, what happens? Because obviously if she's pregnant, something must happen. We never read about her having a baby in the novel. How could she be pregnant? Now
does she have a miscarriage? That'd be sad.
It could be, and for that's not actually what I thought at first, but that's a possibility that I ruled out. And the reason I ruled it out is because there's something else that happens in the novel at just the right time.
Mrs. Weston.
What happens with Mrs. Weston?
Mrs. Weston is all of a sudden preggers, right?
Yeah.
Oh, snap. I know where this is going.
Jane
Fairfax is pregnant. So Mrs. Weston has to be in on it, right?
At some point, she becomes in on
right.
it. Right,
so she's like, what are we going to do with this kid? It would ruin you if you're going to have this baby here. People would still find out about it. I'm married. I'll say that I'm pregnant. Like all of a sudden, hey, I've been 7 months pregnant. Nobody knew.
Right, because don't forget, Mrs. Weston was Emma's governess. She was like 18 or 20 years old when Emma was like a child.
Yeah, so she's older.
She is older.
Which is not to say just because you're older, you can't have kids.
Yeah,
like, that is not, because if that's the truth, I'm screwed.
It is less, I mean, if she was Isabella, Emma's older sister's governess, then she was, 20 when Isabella was born.
Right.
And so she gets married, married on a dime. Remember, there's one at the beginning of the novel. It's like all of a sudden, mysteriously, and again, just like the thing with the name Jane being an emphasis, there's this big focus on how they get married. And Emma
Miss Taylor.
Ostensibly, it's because Emma takes pride in her matchmaking abilities, and then Knightley says it was a lucky guess. Knightley knows that it's no lucky guess at all, because he also knows what's going on from the beginning too.
Oh, okay. Well, before we get into that, so basically Mrs. Weston knows what's going on. She knows it would ruin Jane Fairfax.
That's why she marries Mr. Weston at that moment. Yeah.
So Miss Taylor, before she was Mrs. Weston, knows that Jane Fairfax is pregnant. So she marries Mr. Weston, so then she can pretend it's her baby.
Right, even though that's plan B, though. Plan A is something else.
Well, plan B would have been go to the pharmacy and not.
No. There was no plan C at that time. So plan B is sort of, if nothing else works, she'll slip the baby to Mrs. Weston on the sly.
Taylor know? Would Miss Bates have told her?
They're part of this female network. You see, Jane Austen.
Jane Fairfax spent basically part of every year in Highbury. So everybody knew. Okay, sorry.
There's also a pre-story to Emma. There is all, you know, Mr. Woodhouse's first name is Henry.
This is delicious.
Yes, Henry.
Okay, we know that Kristen loves the Austen heroes that are named Henry.
Well, and I forgot to mention that I've been saying all throughout the podcast, oh, Henrys are so charming.
Because then one of Jane Austen's brothers.
Yes, that was a charming brother. And then I reread Emma, and I'm like, wait, his name is Henry. And I was like, that doesn't fit. So, Arnie, tell us how it fits.
Because think about a historical, Jane Austen. Jane Austen had, in my opinion, an encyclopedic knowledge of history, English history going, you know, she wrote when she was 16 years old, she wrote a parodic history of England. I'm sure you know about that.
Yes.
Including in which there is a charade that she writes about James the First having a male lover who is his pet. And Jane Austen is 16 years old and talking about.
Look at her. She knew
all about anal
Jane
sex.
Austen would, whoa, okay. Jane Austen would have totally been a slash fanfic writer.
Harry and Draco.
All of her novels are slash fiction. That's another whole thing here. They're all slash fiction.
Except
there's like gay and there's gay and lesbian characters.
Oh, please, like William and Darcy were.
No, it's Bingley. Arnie's going to say Bingley and Darcy every time he says that. You know, every time he says that, I shut him down because I have open mind only so far. Anyway,
well, what about Charlotte and Elizabeth?
Oh, damn. This is how I feel about the Harry Hermione shippers, though, where I'm like, there's really no canon support for that. But the thing with Arnie's theories is that he can point to specific.
It's another topic for another discussion. But there is slash material in every single one of the novels because I think Jane Austen was bisexual is my conclusion.
Oh wow!
Part of the shadow story is that it's also a gay and lesbian shadow story.
Okay, well let's get back to the actual
shadow story.
Right.
Okay.
So Jane Fairfax is pregnant. She comes to Highbury so that she won't be disgraced.
And she has to go through the pregnancy, but there's also plan A, I say, is that she wants to find a husband.
Right. So Frank Churchill is not the father in this.
Well, that's brilliant that you said that, because everybody thinks it must be Frank. And
she's pregnant, it would be Frank, right? Because they were secretly
married. You are going to lose your damn mind when you figure out who the father is, when Arnie tells you who the father
is. Is it Mr. What? Dixon?
No.
It's
no,
not Mr. Dixon?
No, you're losing your damn mind.
It's okay. Mr. Dixon in quotes. Because one of the things about what Jane Austen does is that Emma is always almost right. She's almost right. And then people talk her out of, in the shadow story, they talk her out of it. So she thinks it's Mr. Dixon and whatever. So who is a married man who is unhappily married, who has known her from childhood, who is in proximity to her because she lives in London. So this man is a married man living in London, unhappily married. Who am I talking about?
Okay, I know who you're going to say because I read your blog. But, okay, you're talking about Mr. Knightley's brother,
yes,
Mr. John Knightley. But
that's right.
Is he unhappily married?
Yes,
that
he is.
That is not my...
She's an idiot. He's married to a moron, and he's a brilliant... He's a bit of an asshole, but he's a very smart guy.
Well, this
he's
is a
married
very,
to an idiot.
This is a very common theme in Austen too. Yes. Is that smart men,
Mr. Bennet and Mrs. Bennet, right?
Idiots, the Palmers,
right?
In Sense and Sensibility, smart men marry idiots because
they're
hot.
Pretty idiots, right? Yeah.
Yeah. No matter what you say, Emma, men do not want silly wives.
She's always giving those kind of winks. That kind of line, and it's a striking part of her technique, is that the most memorable lines are the most significant lines in the shadow story.
She must have seen that a lot in her everyday life, though, right? Where I mean, and to be fair, women back then there was not a priority on educating women.
Oh, it was the opposite.
Priority was, can you embroider,
make it silks.
Yeah.
You know, like,
so I don't want to make it sound like
screens.
It is not the fault of these ladies, but that is definitely a theme in her novels, I think. So your theory is that Mr. John Knightley is the father of Jane Fairfax's child.
Exactly. And that's undoable. And that's why if you read the discussion that she has with him in chapter 34, that's the moment when she's doing a lot of talking because he's there. That was part of what made me realize that, is that that whole conversation about letters, delivery, what is delivery? This is wordplay. This is the delivery of a special delivery letter. This is talking about her pregnancy. Everybody knows that the topic, except
Emma. Oh, Kristen. Kristen is being very vulgar with her hand movements here.
I had way too much wine.
Kristen is actually full on drunk, I should point out. This is kind of amazing.
Pretty soon you're going to be like Donald Trump and Marco Rubio. This is not good. You must not do this.
I'm sorry.
This is a serious conversation.
This is what makes our podcast
I'm
great.
I'm sorry. Please continue.
Okay. So now,
John Knightley and Jane Fairfax, and they're talking about delivery.
Let me just say though,
right now, that this is I see support for everything you've said until then. This is when I'm starting to become a doubter, and I say that with great respect because I think that you're brilliant. This is the part where I start to think. So convince me.
Well. Part of the way, I can't convince you in the time frame we have, but what I'm saying to you in all seriousness is go back and read chapter 34.
Okay.
Really carefully, about 10 times. Just read it, wake, go to sleep, wake up, read it again. You'll begin to see some of the puns and the winks that are going on there because these things emerge. It's sort of like a photographic negative that develops and you know how the picture sort of comes in.
Right.
That's what's happening in your brain with these shadows. That's how I do crossword puzzles. You know, I look at the clues, they don't make any sense, I can't think of anything. By the time I'm done doing the puzzle, and because I do it a lot, it happens in 15 minutes.
Arnie, this happens to you in 12 minutes. Like, this is not, like, go to sleep, well, like, you make these connections in 12 minutes. I don't know if my brain can do that.
But I've been practicing, no, you can, because you have, just like, you might be someone who says, I can't do crossword puzzles.
Well, it's flexing a muscle, right?
I got my wife, who was brilliant. She couldn't do a Monday puzzle if her life depended on it. She couldn't even do a US Today puzzle when she started about 10 years ago.
Oh, she couldn't even do USA Today.
Now she does the hard New York Times puzzles because she stuck with it. And then she tells me, she's a psychologist, she tells me she feels that this has sort of spread through her own creativity in her practice as a psychologist, that she sees things more clearly and more quickly. Jane Austen understood this. This process of trying to develop her readers' minds. If she could get readers to reread her novels, and we reread her novels because they're so amazing. So even if you don't know these shadows, you reread her novels because they're so much fun and they're so romantic and they're so smart. If you keep rereading them, then eventually these things pop up. That's why it popped up for me on the fourth reading of Sense and Sensibility. And then it took me 3 years to realize that this was going on all over the place in her novels. It's a gradual process. So why would I convince you in 15 minutes? You have to be, as an article of suspending disbelief, you have to say, he may be right, and the only way I'm gonna know is if I give it a chance. If you don't give it a chance, it won't happen for you.
When I think about this, I think about those pictures in the 90s that were really popular, where it just looked like a bunch of wavy line. You have to unfocus your eyes.
And George Costanza.
Like in Mallrats. It's a sailboat.
I like in Mallrats. Oh my God.
But I had one of those.
But Arnie, talk about the crying.
Who's crying?
Jane.
Jane Fairfax.
John Knightley is there and they're talking about the
Male. Because he's saying, I'm not going to marry you. He's basically saying, he says, I hope you have many more, whatever it is. I forget the euphemism he uses.
So the conversation is about concentrated objects of affection.
That's a baby.
Well, she's a conversation about she loves the mail because she's getting mail from people that she loves, you know, the Campbells. Mm-hmm. And she's talking about, oh, my objects of affection, you know, that my family and everything, they're scattered. And, you know, so
are they in Ireland at this point?
Yes. The Campbells are in Ireland with Mr. Dixon. Anyway. So what she's saying is, John Knightley, you know, you don't think the mail is important because everybody, all of your family is with you in your house.
Right.
And that's a little bit of an accusation. And John Knightley said, well, I hope someday all of your objects of affection are in yours.
In other words, you're going to have your own family with your own children, and we can't be together because I'm married to her, and there's nothing I can do about it. That's what he's saying to her. Now, I want to get back to...
And she gets misty-eyed. Okay.
Exactly. And Emma has no idea. Now, why would Jane Austen show us that tear? You know the famous statement that Chekhov made about if he shows a gun at the beginning of the play, it's going to go off before the end, and it's going to be important.
This is like Jane Fairfax's vagina is the gun.
all these, that's one way of putting it. No, all these little micro details that are atmospheric in the overt story, they mean nothing. They have no something you can hang your hat on as to what they mean. You'd be wildly guessing if you tried to say why she cries at that moment.
No. In the overt story, she is very upset. She has to be a governess. I think you'll see
that. Oh, true. Okay. True. Right. Okay. In any good double entendre, the surface has to work really well. Yeah. Or else it's not a good double entendre. Yeah. So it's no. I mean, I get constantly people saying, "Well, it works so well in the way we read it the normal way." And I'd say, "Well, if it didn't, then nobody would even read the damn novel in the first place."
Right.
It's got to be working. A good double entendre goes both ways. Now, I'd like to get back so that we don't get too far, of course, to plan A. When Jane comes to Highbury, I'm saying that what she's primarily looking to do, she doesn't want to give away her baby. Right. She wants to find a husband that will be willing to be the father to it. That's why she goes to Weymouth once she realizes that she's pregnant. And that's where she seeks out Frank Churchill, who she knows all about, because he's available. He's a rich prospective heir from the hometown. He's just like her, blah, blah, blah. So she makes him feel, it's sort of like with Marianne and Willoughby, the same thing. At first I thought he was stalking her. Then one day it occurred to me 8 years later, maybe she put herself where he would find her, because because Marianne Dashwood's in the same problem as Jane Fairfax. She's pregnant already.
And she
needs a farmer. Yes. Okay. But
we haven't gotten into Sense and Sensibility yet.
We haven't got over there. But I'm saying she repeated these memes in different novels. And in some places it's more visible than in the others, et cetera. So she was trying to get Frank to marry her. And Frank at first is all too interested, even though I think he's bisexual. I think that he, which is why, by the way, Amy Heckerling has the Frank character be gay.
Yeah.
She picked up on this. She picked up on his sexual ambiguity very well. But I think that Frank goes both ways, and therefore he would have been happy to marry Jane. But what happens is, as he's sitting there and they're watching Jane sing, remember when Jane sings and Knightley gets all pissed off because Frank is making her sing and whatever. And then later, or before or later, Frank is sitting there with Emma and they're whispering about Mr. Dixon. All this kind of
Mr.
stuff.
Dixon.
What happens is there's a moment there where Frank pauses and he's like, he seems like there's something that indicates he's astonished, and he stops in the middle of a sentence and he pauses. And then he looks at Emma, and then Emma says something completely clueless, and then he realizes Emma has no idea what it is that he's seen. What he has seen is that Jane is pregnant. He had no clue until that moment that Jane was pregnant and that he was about to get stuck with a pregnant woman who was not coming to him because she really is interested in him, but who's looking for a father. And then another giant piece of the puzzle is another character we haven't even mentioned yet, who is the most nauseating character in the...
Who's
the
most
Elton. And Mrs. Elton.
Mrs. Elton. Mr. E. And Mrs. Elton.
Now I have to do a slight digression and tell you something that you wouldn't otherwise realize.
Oh, we can't support any digressions.
You guys, you're always right on the point. You know, there's this charade in Emma, of course, the one that Emma and Harriet try to solve, right? Harriet is struggling.
Yeah, the riddle. Fortune.
Well, not even just the riddle. There's three. There's a mini charade that's like four lines. Then there's the big charade that's like three or four stanzas. And then there's Mr. Woodhouse in his syphilitic haze coming in and trying to remember.
Oh, snap! I think that's another shadow plot.
I'm not the one who.
I told you it wasn't dementia. Well, syphilis causes dementia.
Oh, blah, blah.
Jill Hikes.
Alzheimer's. Yeah, right.
Jill, this is what part of my luck is that in 1999, Jill Hikes Stevenson, a professor in Colorado, came up with this theory that blew the roof off of Jane Austen studies, because she suggested that the riddle that he's trying to remember, actually, if you read all the verses of it, is clearly a salacious sort of commentary about having syphilis, basically. And this is, trust me, if you read it's so obvious that this is a dirty thing that David Garrick wrote. Why is Mr. Woodhouse trying to remember this? Well, it indicates, excuse me, that he has some issues that relate to that. But the charade that Emma says the answer to which is courtship, I don't know if you're aware of this, but it has another, at least one other answer. And you can go to the JASNA website and you can read the article by the person who discovered this, whose name is Colleen Sheehan. And she's someone I became friendly with 11 years ago. And then she found this amazing second answer. The second answer of the charade is the Prince of Wales. But Prince of Wales, not A-L-E-S, but H-A-L-E-S. In other words, a whale.
Like Moby Dick, a whale.
Like Moby Dick, a whale, which, by the way, has Prince of Wales in it. Moby Dick, the novel, actually picks up on this in some way. Maybe it's related to Emma, I think. That was the Prince Regent. The Prince Regent was like 300 pounds and had this rare blood disease, plus he was a glutton and a wastrel.
Man, I wish I had gotten that guy.
He was like Chris Christie, but worse. And he was, way beyond the pale, and he was ridiculed for this very publicly, right? Because he was such an asshole as a leader, he drew this kind of ridicule from his people. They didn't love him and look the other way. They ridiculed him. So it's been proven beyond any reasonable doubt that that is going on underneath the charade that supposedly is about courtship. What does that tell us about Jane Austen?
So she makes a political joke.
On the guy that she dedicated the novel to, she's skewering him in the most obnoxious way. Well, it also turns out that charade is an anagram acrostic. It has the different standards, two standards begin with the letters L, A, M, and B. What does that spell? Not in that order. Well, Charles Lamb, who wrote the Prince of Wales poem, that, and then there's the thing I have at my blog, that Cruikshank caricature that has the whale with all the people floating around. This was in the air in 1812 and 1813 at the very moment Jane Austen was writing Emma. This was out there, this whole controversy about the Prince Regent. So,
okay, well, let's get back to the...
But here's the punchline. It's also an acrostic because L, A, M, and B, these are the letters of the beginning of the two stanzas. And remember that there's another character who talks about an acrostic. Do you remember who it is and in what circumstance?
I'm sure Kristen does.
Mrs. Elton.
What does she say? Do you remember?
She said an acrostic was sent to me on my own name, which was Augusta, by the way. An acrostic was sent to me on my own name. It was sent by an abominable puppy. And then she says to Mr. Elton, you know who I mean. And she nods at him.
Okay, now, do you have any idea who that person is?
I know, because you told me.
Okay.
I have no idea what the hell either of you are talking about.
All right, well, then maybe people listening will be confused, too. There is a scene that Kristen has just described. It happens in, like, the later chapters after Mrs. Obviously, because Mrs. Elton is there, and she's speaking very suggestively and very significantly about a puppy. You know who I mean. Now, that could be nothing. It could be a character who never appears in the novel, and that would, again, be like Chekhov's gun. It would be stupid for Jane Austen to have done this if it was for no reason. So one day, about 7 or 8 years ago, after I already knew about the Prince of Wales and the acrostic and all this stuff, it's like it percolated in my brain. And one day I realized, oh my God, the charade that Mr. Elton brings to Emma is the acrostic that is given to Mrs. Elton when she's Miss Hawkins. It's the same thing. And that's when I realized, if you remember How I Met Your Mother, did you ever watch How I Met Your Mother?
Yeah. I did the first couple seasons.
Frank and Mr. Elton are wingmen to each other. They're on the single circuit together in London. And guess who gives that charade to Miss Hawkins? Frank!
So Frank Churchill was...
is the abominable puppy. He's the abominable puppy who she's... And of course, she would be winking suggestively because he's in the room there at the very moment. Right there.
So I want to... I'm fascinated with the Jane Fairfax's pregnant theory because I think that's kind of the overall...
Yeah.
Theory. So if we're going through plot wise, so we've gotten to the part where Mrs. Weston is now saying she's pregnant. Tell me what happens in the shadow story.
Well, what happens is Frank doesn't want to marry Jane, right?
Okay, so Frank is not actually in love with Jane. He's engaged to her, but he's
not. No, he's never engaged to her.
Okay, so he finds out she's pregnant.
That's a cover story that is created at the end of the novel. How do you find out all that stuff? He writes this long letter, which is an entire chapter of the novel, is his letter. Now, when was the last time that a letter written by an extremely deceitful young man, is taken as gospel? And yet people read that letter as though it's reciting all the facts of what actually happened. In fact, he's, in my opinion, he's writing that letter because Mr. Knightley has basically a gun to his head and is saying, if you don't write this letter and marry Jane Fairfax now, I'm going to tell the world what you did to your aunt when she died.
So this is George Knightley, who knows that John Knightley is the father.
He knows everything.
Okay,
and he forces Frank to say that they were engaged so that this cover story will mask over all this stuff of an unmarried, unengaged young woman getting pregnant, knocked up by his brother. They need to solve this problem. And that's why you have that whole tête-à-tête in chapter 5 between Mrs. Western and Mr. Knightley at the beginning. Go back and reread that sometime.
Where they're talking about Frank Churchill.
And they're talking about Emma, and it's a moment where they say, we're not going to remember that, like something that happened 2 years ago. We're not going to remember that because that's too terrible. And then there's a silence. What the hell is that about?
The scene where Mr. Knightley tells Mrs. Weston that she was an awful governess?
Yes. Okay. And it's also the one where he acts like he's not interested in Emma, whereas I believe he's been interested in her from the beginning. Why would he be interested in Emma if he doesn't really love her?
Right.
Because she's the heiress of Hartfield, and he may have some cash flow issues. And how do we know that he has
cash flow issues? Oh, Arnie, why do you have to ruin all of the romance
Until he starts talking about Pride and Prejudice.
Don't
block
my face.
I can talk drunkenly into the mic if I want.
You're going to be embarrassed later.
All right. All right. So I'm saying that Mrs. Elton is the proverbial woman scorned. Think about it. If she was actually scorned by Frank, who would she blame for taking him away from her?
What, Jane?
Yes. And then why does she have this obsession with Jane and want to look at her?
Well, everybody does, right?
But she particularly has an obsession with Jane, is hovering over her, and it makes everybody super uncomfortable.
Yeah. Why does Jane shouldn't go check your mail. You're so sickly. You shouldn't walk down the lane. It's like, what you
It's more than that. She wants to take her in the carriage. She's hovering over her. When they go to Box Hill, she says, Jane will stay with us or whatever. Why does Jane tolerate this? Because she knows that she'll be outed as pregnant if she doesn't keep her mouth shut. What is Mrs. Elton trying to accomplish? This is horrible. Where is she trying to get Jane to go?
To
Mrs.
Smallridge. To be a governess way far
away. Think about governess as street slang for something else. What would a governess might be?
Are you making like prostitution?
She's trying to sell her off into the black market. Of course. And there is a Shakespeare play that
makes me sad.
This is not a comedy.
Oh, when was Jane Eyre written?
Much later.
Oh, okay.
But
there is that theory.
Charlotte Bronte was a Jainite. She said the word is that she wasn't. She was, and her novels are permeated with Austen material from beginning, and especially Jane Eyre. Is all about Jane Austen. That's why Rochester's name is Fairfax, for Christ's sake. It's not an accident. It's all Jane and Fairfax, all of it.
Name is Fairfax?
One of his names is Edward Fairfax Rochester, something like that. It's like his mother's maiden name or something like that is Fairfax, which would make sense that Rochester is Jane's son.
So by the way, Bay just sent me a message on his phone because he's not allowed to talk on the podcast. That he just wants you to know that this is amazeballs.
Really good? Is that like his way of saying
it? Yeah, amazeballs means like, this is so great.
Awesome sauce.
You mean his balls are completely amazed by everything we're talking about?
Whoa.
I mean, I'm trying to understand your language.
Thumbs up. So amazeballs just means like my mind is being blown.
It means amazing.
Yeah.
This should happen.
But just to be clear, it sounds like in the Shadow story, basically, Mr. Woodhouse is like syphilis, Swiss cheese brain, but it sounds like everyone basically knows what's going on except Emma.
Yes. There was a movie with Bill Murray, which is not that great a movie, but it was called The Man Who Knew Too Little. It came out about 20 years ago. What happens in this movie, this everyday guy, it's sort of like a parody of North by Northwest by Hitchcock, where this ordinary guy thinks he's getting caught up in a reality game where, what do they call it, where you act like it's a real life thing, but it's not, I forget the word for it. But anyway, it turns out he gets enmeshed in a real spy ring that he doesn't even know about, with people being shot and killed and everything, but he just sort of blunders through.
True Lies.
Yeah.
Right? Where the wife character thinks that she's it, but it's really fake. Yeah. But then it turns
Total Recall. Like where they're creating this managed reality.
Oh God, I love that movie. Yeah. Get your ass to Mars.
Arnold. So anyway, in all seriousness, you're right. Emma is the only one who doesn't know what the F is going on.
Why doesn't anyone clue Emma in? Is it because it's complicated?
Because it's better that she not know, because there's a strand which he won't like, which is that Knightley doesn't want her to know because he wants to marry her. And he's a pedophile. He is a pedophile.
13 years old.
Yeah.
He is a pedophile.
We talked about that.
Is where Gigi, you know, the movie Gigi with Mira. This is based on Emma in part. It's picking up on the same horrible vibe of this.
Saying that Gigi's based on Emma, is that something that is like known, or is it something that you've discovered?
Something I'm saying, because it's so similar to what I'm describing in the Shadow Story, that to me it's the same. What's her name? Claudette, whoever wrote it, would have known. Everybody knew Jane Austen. That's the thing. By the time we get to the 20th century, every writer who's anybody.
Why do we know he's a pedophile? This is something I did not understand.
Well, he's interested in Emma at that, you know, and Andrew Davis spoke about. Yeah, he's revealing the truth about himself. And for that matter, Mr. Woodhouse, I wanted to get back to why he's named Henry.
Oh, right. We totally dropped that. Sorry.
In my opinion, and I am not alone in having speculated this, there's a whole bunch of children of doubtful parentage in the novel. It's not just Harriet Smith, who nobody knows quite who is her father.
Well, Jane Fairfax is an orphan.
Jane is an orphan. Frank is they died when he was young, blah, blah, blah. Who from English history named Henry had a bunch of children by different wives who were all vying for the throne?
Henry the Eighth?
That's Mr. Woodhouse. Mr. Woodhouse. Mr. Woodhouse is Henry.
We're going with the Eighth, right? Henry the Eighth.
Yeah. Yeah. Jane Austen has recreated in Highbury, high, like the court high, pun, right? Has recreated the story of Henry the Eighth with all these different children sort of buzzing around and incest in the air.
There are less decapitations, though.
Are you saying that Henry Woodhouse is the father of Harriet Smith?
Of everybody. He's the father
of
everybody.
Frank Churchill?
And Jane Fairfax.
Why aren't they syphilitic babies?
Because they were conceived before.
Before syphilis? Blow our minds about Hetty real fast.
And I know.
Well, actually, there was a theory by a Janeite from 20 years ago that you can find in the Jasna publication. What's her name? From Rochester. I forget her name. But anyway, she came up with the idea that at the time was very risque, that Miss Bates might be the mother of Harriet. Because Hetty and Henrietta, Harriet, whatever, is the same person. That was actually
Miss Bates' name.
Miss Bates is surely the mother of Jane. She's surely the mother of
Miss Bates. Wait, Miss Bates is the mother of Jane or Harriet?
Absolutely. There was no sister. There is no sister.
Wait, what? She's the mother of both.
She's the mother of Jane. There's different mothers for different, you know, Mrs. Weston is probably the mother of Emma. I'm not quite sure because this is understandably murky. But I have my speculations as to who is who, but it just rang true in my mind that this is Henry VIII with children scattered all over the place with different mothers, males and females and all the rest of it.
And we all know that Henry VIII, as he said, the love of his life was actually Jane.
Now stop.
The wife that he liked the most.
That's right.
Was Jane.
That's right. That's right. Well,
Jane Seymour.
But stop for a second.
I will.
Stop. Collaborate and listen.
Hold on. Actually, this is funny because I was writing an email to Kristen earlier where I was like giving an outline of our podcast, and I had a part where I put Arnie time, and before that I put stop, Arnie time. I didn't know if she would get it, and I should have trusted.
This has all worked out just fine. Go ahead, Kristen.
So we talked about this in an earlier podcast. It was a convention to name the daughter after the mother.
Yeah.
The mother, Miss
like,
Bates.
Like Lorelai and Rory.
And Rory.
Right.
Miss Bates, her nickname is Hetty.
Right.
Which you think is Harriet. Presumably it's Henrietta. It could also be Harriet.
Exactly.
Harriet Smith is named Harriet.
Yeah.
And that's the connection.
And she loves her. She loves her.
Yeah.
Now, I don't know how much longer we have, so I want to make sure there's a couple of points we don't miss, and then whatever remaining time we have, can go wherever this.
Finish off the plot for us. I want to hear about the murder because I think that's awesome. Oh,
Frank murdered his wife, his aunt, not his
wife. I mean, clearly, right? Who just like kicks off at this most convenient
time? And if you read the language, it's quintessential wordplay by Jane Austen because it says after a brief struggle. A brief struggle. It didn't say, right, it's like kill. And then I put the pieces together. I'm like Columbo. I said, well, why does Nightwing?
One more question, Arnie.
I'm just laughing.
What?
No, that's the joke. That's the joke.
That's a Columbo
joke. Did he say that? I didn't watch Columbo.
So. Arnie.
Oh, come on.
Oh, my God. Okay, so let me explain the joke. So when,
go ahead.
When Columbo is interviewing a suspect, he'll go through the whole interview and he'll be like, all right, well, thank you. But he knows what's really going on and he walks away. He'll turn around and go, one more thing. And then he like nails
it. I got it. And you know who else does stuff in a different way, the same thing, and is based on Jane Austen as well, is Miss Marple by Agatha Christie.
Oh, I see that. Mm. Oh, this is like my idea that I had in an earlier podcast where we do the Jane Austen mysteries.
Yeah, that's right.
Where Jane Austen is in Steventon.
Why do you think that Emma is called the detective novel without a murder? And the fact of it is a detective novel and there is a murder. But
okay,
you know,
so let's back up and get back to the plot because I want to know how this ends.
So
Frank Churchill doesn't want to marry Jane Fairfax. But
Mr.
Knightley tells him, he's like, you're going to marry her. It's like Darcy with Wickham. He's like, no, you're marrying her.
And actually, in the end, they don't marry. You know why they don't? How you know they don't marry?
You're jumping ahead. You're jumping ahead, though.
No, but let me say, they don't marry because if you read what Jane Austen says at the end of the novel, we have all these weddings taking place together, right? You have Harriet and what's his name?
Robert Martin.
And you have Emma and Knightley, and the Eltons have already gotten married. But it says, as for Jane, and they were going to wait for November. It says they're going to wait for November, which means they're not going to get married. And that's why we're told about her, Frank, resetting the Churchill family jewels for Jane, right? You're going to make them into a gift. What's really happening here is that she no longer needs to marry him. The baby's already been given to Mrs. Weston. The reason for the sham marriage no longer exists. But there had to have been a sham engagement.
Kristen
all along.
Has a point.
Everything. What?
No. Blow our minds about the baby's name.
Okay, but wait, you guys, we're skipping too far ahead. Remember, I don't know the whole theory. So
okay.
We're still
all right. So, well, let me get back to
George Knightley convinces Frank Churchill to marry Jane Fairfax.
He doesn't just convince him. He basically says, if you don't, I'm going to out your murder of your aunt.
He's already murdered the aunt at this point.
That's right, because why does Knightley suddenly leave in a big rush to leave Highbury to go off to London to hang out with John? Well, what if that's all BS? What he's really doing is going to find Frank, who's already escaped from Highbury, right? He just skips right out of after Box Hill. He's out on the midnight horse, and he's gone. Knightley goes and finds him as Frank is writing the letter to his aunt, you know, that one, the one we find in chapter 50. He gets about halfway through the letter, writing it the way he wanted to write it, and then Knightley shows up. So then he says, like, a pause in the middle of the letter, and you can read it. It's so amazing. And it says, oh, I had to walk away for a few minutes and cool down or whatever. And then suddenly he's on track, because Knightley has basically said, you write it this way, which gets back to the whole idea of who wrote Robert Martin's letter in the first place, right? Remember way back with ghostwriting of letters and Knightley figures out that Emma has ghostwritten Harriet's refusal, right? But what a lot of people have said is that Knightley wrote Robert Martin's letter, which is why it's so smart and so clever. It's because Knightley wrote it. That's why he gets so damn upset when it's not accepted, because he wrote the damn letter himself.
That's actually I really like that. It's very cute. Yeah, Aside from the overall shadow plot, that's a really cute idea that he and Emma are both kind of Cyrano, Bergerac.
But then I extended it to this final letter of Frank's and said he did the same thing there too. He's right. Knightley is the Oberon of this Midsummer Night's Dream, if you know Midsummer Night's Dream.
Yes, Knightley, and actually, I want to talk to you about Shakespeare later.
Okay, so I think the only other two areas we haven't covered yet, which we can do now pretty quickly, is Harriet. Because asking you now, if you don't already, it's not cheating because you already know. What could be motivating Harriet to suck up to Emma and flatter her and do all this stuff? Maybe Harriet is the moron and the gullible idiot that she seems to be. Is there another possibility about it, Harriet, in your imagination? Is there another explanation that could account for her behavior?
You mentioned that you think Mr. Woodhouse is basically everyone's dad. So if Harriet was Emma's sister, maybe?
Yes.
Is that what you're going for?
No, no, what I'm going for is that what if Harriet is not an idiot? What could explain her behavior? What if she's not the idiot that she seems to be? What if she's actually the Harriet who actually tells Emma? Remember the scene when Harriet confronts Emma, and when Emma finally realizes that Harriet is interested in Knightley, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What if you read that speech again, Harriet, her manner of speaking is completely different there than it was in any other point before, and we almost don't see her after that scene. But all before that, it's, oh, Miss Woodhouse, you're so smart with Miss Woodhouse. I don't know what to think, Mrs. Woodhouse. Suddenly in this speech, it's like, you know, a half a page of literate adult diction, like a mature, intelligent person speaking and actually horrifying Emma with this sudden thing, well, you know, whatever. What if that's the real Harriet all along? What if
she's almost like a Scarlet Pimpernel style character where she plays the fop, but she's super smart.
Or to take the what I think was the main source for her, for Jane Austen. You know that Samuel Richardson wrote this very famous novel called, he wrote several, that Jane Austen knew them all, and nobody argues about this. One of the first one was Pamela. Then there was Sir Charles Grandison. Then there was Clarissa, right? These three, huge, gigantic epistolary novels.
In love with Sean Bean, right, Clarissa.
Right. Exactly.
On Masterpiece Theater.
So with Pamela, you have this young housemaid who is a servant, whatever, housemaid, who is being, you know, basically sexually stalked by her master, Mr. B, for the half the novel. And then she's in fear of him and all this kind of stuff. Eventually, she winds up marrying him. Well, did you know that Henry Fielding, who wrote Tom Jones, who was a contemporary of Samuel Richardson, he wrote a parody of Pamela called Shamala, S-H-A-M, like a sham, like a fake, like a sham, Shamala. In which you have the same character shown to be a deceiver, a flatterer and a deceiver who's pretending to be an idiot in order to gain her, get somewhere in the world. That's Harriet Smith in The Shadow Story.
Okay.
She's the opposite of an idiot, which is why her answers to the charade are actually pointing to the Prince of Wales.
So then why is she sucking up to Emma, though?
Because she wants to get to Knightley all along from the
beginning. So she does want to get to George.
She's sucking up to Emma to get to Knightley.
Okay.
And so, now to please Kristen, I'm going to reveal the one discovery about Emma that is not mine, and I want to give proper credit to the right person. About 2007, after I've already gone public with what I've been talking to you about now in the group and horrifying and appalling large numbers of Janeites in every direction, I was approached by another Janeite who I had sort of seen her footprint on the internet but had never spoken to her or emailed with her. Her name is Anjelka Briggs. She's an Australian who lived in England for a while. And she's actually a descendant of one of Edward Austen, the brother Edward Austen, the rich brother. She's a descendant like nine times removed or whatever in some way from the Rice part of that family. She contacts me and she says, I've been reading about you. I think we have a lot in common in our approach. And long story short, we had a conversation. I was in brief contact with her for a few weeks by phone. Which was interesting, 12 hours apart, you know, between Florida and Australia. And I proceeded to tell her in an hour conversation everything I just told you about Emma. This was 9 years ago, 8.5 years ago. And at the end of it, stopped talking. She sends me an email that night and says, I know who the baby was. And I write her back and I say, I don't get it. I told you the baby is Jane Fairfax's baby. Her name is Anna Weston. That's who the baby is. She says, no, I know who the baby was in real life. And of course I get like, woo. And so we wind up having a conversation and I can't guess what she's talking about. I have no idea because I can tease other people who can't guess what I'm teasing at, but I couldn't figure out what she was teasing at. Well, do you play Scrabble?
Oh, I'm awful.
All right, but you know how to play Scrabble.
I'm the worst.
The Scrabble tiles.
He's freaking out because he's apparently like the Scrabble king, I guess.
All right, think of the name Anna, listen to me, Anna Weston, A-N-N-A-W-E-S-T-O-N.
I'm awful at anagrams too.
See this in your mind. It's not even an anagram, it's visible.
Okay.
Now, how would you manipulate the letters? And then A W E is pronounced
aw,
and then S T
Jane Austen, goddamn.
No, it's Anna Austen.
Jane Austen, goddamn it. to be like, why are you so thick?
And Anna Austen.
This is why I don't see these things.
Do you know who Anna Austen was in real life?
Okay, Anna Austen. No.
Anna Austen was her niece, or at least people think it was her niece.
So she was giving a clue as to her niece's parentage.
But wait.
If you didn't have the shadow story of Emma that I've described to you with this baby swap that goes on off stage, what would that appear to be? Well, it would appear to be a kind of an homage to her beloved niece. This was her niece who wrote. This was the niece that she gave writing advice to and wrote about the four or five families in a country village and 2 inches of ivory.
Don't you find it unbearing? 4 and 20. Okay, sorry. Yeah.
So this was this was the writing niece, okay? The one that she was very attached to, whose mother died when she was very young, supposedly, and then eventually she had the evil stepmother, which was her brother James's wife, Mary, etc. So it would look like, in the surface, if you didn't know anything about the shadow story of Emma, it would look like this was like an homage to her niece. Like, here, Mr. and Mrs. Weston are my brother James and his wife, Mary, and this is their daughter, Anna, and I'm sort of making this nice in joke for our family of this innocent thing.
But if I'm saying
that it's not really the daughter, yeah, but it's really the daughter of a young single woman, who's the
oh my God,
woman?
Are you telling me that Jane Austen, okay, so Jane Austen had a daughter.
No, or that she liked putting that in as if she had it. In other words, the alternative, I have to say it right away, is not that Anna was really her daughter and that Jane at 16 got knocked up by a local man. It could be that Jane was so attached to her niece that she felt like it was her daughter who got taken away from her. So
that's the nicer way of putting it.
But isn't that remarkable that this sort of synergy between me and this other scholar, like lightning struck for just 1 minute, right, and something I found that was unbelievable, something that she figured out like within 24 hours, and it exploded when it went together.
But let me also go back to the question that I asked Arnie when I was first got curious about this whole story.
When she was young and innocent.
Why is Jane Bennett named Jane? Why is Jane Fairfax named Jane? They both be sick.
You're going to hate why the reason, because it's the same reason.
Why?
Jane Bennett is sick. She's sick for the same reason Jane Fairfax is sick.
Everyone's pregnant.
Jane Bennett gets sick. She goes away. She stays in London. Yeah. For a long time.
So you're saying in Pride and Prejudice, Jane's pregnant by Bingley? Is she pregnant by Bingley?
No, just like it's not Frank it's somebody who is so awful you can't stand. You're gone.
I don't want to. No, we're here. We're here. Sorry.
It's so awful that it is beyond awful. And remember, there's a scene in Pride and Prejudice where they're in the Netherfield Salon, and Mrs. Bennet is there boasting about Jane being so pretty and how when she was 16, when she was in London, there was this guy who made a poem on her, wrote a sonnet for her, but then he sort of flaked and he was gone. Do you know who that was?
Who was it?
It's the person who defends that guy. And you know, when Elizabeth makes a sneering comment and says, oh, it was probably a sonnet that was gonna starve away. Like, she makes a derogatory comment about the sonnet. And then somebody pipes up and said, but I thought poetry was the food of love. Who says that?
I don't remember. Just tell me. Oh no! Come on.
They've been involved the whole time.
Okay, Kristen's taking a bathroom break.
A welcome bathroom break.
Yeah. Okay. She can edit this out if she wants, but I think it's kind of hilarious, so you should leave it in.
That's the reason. They're both named Jane.
Before you take away all the romance for me, Arnie, I think that we've now kind of covered the shadow story and Emma, and my mind has been completely blown. So I want to get back. Remember, I said I was going to ask you about Shakespeare. And I think this is a good time to do it, because you have now, from the shadow story of Emma, extrapolated some ideas into Jane Austen's character, into her life. And a couple years ago, I attended this really interesting discussion at the Shakespeare Folger Library here in DC about the authorship question, the Shakespeare authorship question. Was it actually Shakespeare who wrote Shakespeare's plays? And one of the things that the author talked about was the danger of looking at an author's work and finding clues as to their lives within it. And the question is always, how closely can we read fiction text to understand an author's life? I don't know if you know, are familiar with Shakespeare at all, but to me, I find this very interesting, where the people who question the authorship of the Shakespeare plays, and your really close read of Jane Austen, to me, it seems kind of similar. So I don't know if you have a theory about this, or if
I've heard anything about it. In my opinion, Jane Austen learned to do this shadow story deal, or she got inspired to do it by Shakespeare.
So you have dug in. So what is your?
I spent years looking at Shakespeare also.
So do you think? So obviously you think it's fair to look at an author's fiction text and draw from there.
Well, no, that's not so. I noticed how careful I was, which I wasn't at first when I first, the story we told about the baby and Emma and Jane Austen's real life. You noticed in the beginning, I wasn't careful. And I was saying, oh, of course, she had a baby. It was her. I've learned through experience and thinking about it that you shouldn't extrapolate and conclusively decide things like it was she really had a baby or not without other real life evidence to support it. So, but what I am certain of is that she meant to make it look like that was the case, even if it was totally made up by her as a fantasy. As far as Shakespeare is concerned, I absolutely avoid at all costs the authorship controversy.
Right.
Because I think it's doomed. It can never lead anywhere useful, because we really can't know who was really Shakespeare. But ultimately, I don't care.
Does it really matter in the end, right?
What matters is that Shakespeare wrote
these plays exist, these brilliant plays.
And Jane Austen, what happened is that all this stuff I was finding in Jane Austen around about 2007, it was becoming clear to me that Shakespeare had been very important to her, which is something I didn't know when I first started looking at this, because I was ignorant of all the Scholarly literature. But, you know, it's not only that Henry Crawford talks about knowing, or Edmund Bertram talk about knowing Shakespeare by osmosis and all that stuff. It's that I actually read most of Shakespeare during 2006 to 2008, almost all the plays. And then before that, I'd only read like a half dozen of them. I read another 30 of them, because I realized I need to understand Shakespeare better, because it's so crucial for Jane Austen. And early in that process, I focused on Shakespeare's most enigmatic and greatest play, which is, of course, Hamlet, right? And
or another white dude goes crazy and why do I care?
But I'll just tell you this about—
Mine is not like you are. No, obviously I'm being facetious.
But I'll tell you only this, because otherwise this is a whole Pandora's box about Shakespeare that is a whole other—
That's a whole other podcast.
that Hamlet is a double story. And I figured it out. And I'm not the first person to have tried to work it out, but the shadow story of Hamlet, there's a fork in the road of interpreting Hamlet. And it's something that people have been looking at for hundreds of years, but they couldn't figure out how to make it all fit together. Well, I did, and that's going to be in my book that I'm writing.
Oh, okay. So
is the ghost a real ghost? If the ghost is a real ghost in Hamlet, then you have one story. If the ghost is a hallucination of a crazy schizophrenic, it's another story. They're two independent stories.
I think that is actually, I mean, your ideas about Jane Austen's stories, I feel like are like completely new to me, but I've heard those two interpretations of Hamlet. I've heard before. But now that I feel like we've talked a lot about the shadow story and Emma, this might be, you've talked about your theories also about Shakespeare. Are these things available on your blog? This might be a good time to mention how people can learn more if they're interested.
Yes. I mean, I've written very little about Shakespeare publicly, because I've actually preferred to keep most of that in my pocket for a future time. It's like Pandora's box to open that one as well. But almost everything I've been saying to you and a thousand other things about Jane Austen can be found in my blog. The name of the blog is called sharpelvessociety.blogspot.com. So it's the Google blog platform. And I call it the Sharp Elves Society because of Jane Austen's famous comment to her sister about Pride and Prejudice, about the ambiguities of Pride and Prejudice. And she says, but I do not write for such dull elves. And she's quoting at that point Walter Scott in Marmion. I do not write for such dull elves as have not a great deal of ingenuity themselves. And so I figured I'm writing this stuff for the sharp elves who are not the dull elves.
Right.
And I'm also on Twitter. And I also have my email, which is arnieperlstein@gmail.com. So I'd be more than happy to hear from anybody who wants to read in my blog, who wants to contact me, wants to follow me on Twitter, I welcome all of it.
Kristen,
don't forget to say your Twitter handle.
Yeah, what's your Twitter handle?
It's at Jane Austen Code. So one word, like one word.
Like the Jane Da Vinci Austen Code.
Right, no underscores or anything. At Jane Austen Code. And I started tweeting really seriously a couple of years ago. And so you'll find links there. And you'll find any of the Jane Austen novels that you're interested in. You'll find something I've written about it if you go to my blog. Because I got like 1,500 posts there.
I looked at your Twitter, and what I found was interesting. It's not just Jane Austen.
Well, I write about random other stuff.
Which is how I refer to Twitter.
Well, Jane Austen led me to all these other writers. Like when War and Peace was just on Lifetime or whatever. I think Tolstoy was a Janeite. And I saw stuff as I was looking at visiting. So as I look around, I find that everybody, it's like 6 degrees of separation. There is no author before her or after her who is not directly connected to her, who is one of the great authors. They're all engaged with her in some way. It's like this big picture that Jane Austen is the center of a wheel.
Mm-hmm. Well, she is, I think, and again, as we promote on this podcast, she is one of the pillars of English literature, I think is not unfair to say. Whereas she was influenced by Shakespeare, people who came after her were influenced by her.
Especially women, but not only women. But especially women, but also Nabokov and Tolstoy and Mark Twain, you know, all this, especially the ones who said they didn't like Jane Austen. It's a put-on.
Mark Twain. God, it's annoying. So there's a guy I know, and I'm like, listen to my podcast, and he's like, Mark Twain said, and I'm a Mark Twain fan, and I'm like, God damn it.
Mark Twain was a Janeite, Mark, which makes sense.
Was. Because
he was a satirist, and so was she. So he would pick up on her put-ons and her games and everything. And the biggest game was that he didn't like Jane Austen. Right.
I think it's really interesting that this what we respond to is when people give us crap about liking Jane Austen and how they're kind of the romance novels and that's all they are. Is until the movies came out, this didn't really exist as a thing. She was kind of not relegated, but mostly considered in the sphere of scholars and serious literature. And then when the movies came out, that's when the perception of her as more of a frivolous writer started. And then it's so cyclical how her legacy is viewed.
Well, think about it, 40 years ago, how many people were there who were familiar with Jane Austen who hadn't read the novels? Almost none.
Right.
Now you've got this army of people who've seen these one or more of these movies, and as many and more of them get made, half of them are with such crap. They're so far removed, both from the overt stories and the shadow stories. I mean, they're not even creative. They're just going off like the zombies thing or whatever, are so ridiculous that now people have this even more distorted idea about Jane Austen. But I'll say the one movie you really want to see when it comes out, you don't want to miss it because it was amazing. And I saw it at Sundance 6 weeks ago. Is Love and Friendship by Whit Stillman, which is actually an adaptation of Lady Susan, but he called it Love and Friendship.
Is that unpublished?
No, it's published. You haven't read Lady Susan?
You've got to read Lady Susan.
It's not that long. Read Lady Susan and then see this movie. Kate Beckinsale is so unbelievably good in this movie. She should win an Oscar.
Kate Beckinsale in another Austen adaptation?
She was Emma.
Hello. Bringing it back.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I think that this has been fascinating. Arnie, thank you so much for joining us. We really appreciate it.
And you guys have been amazing. You've been exactly what I envisioned that it would be, a dialogue and a very active conversation, and you fulfilled your roles magnificently. So
thank you. Thank you so much. We're just going to give ourselves little props here.
There you go.
I did nothing. Maggie's brilliance was on display in this podcast. So when she makes her next comment about, I just provide the jokes, you'll know that's BS.
Well, I don't know.
Maggie's the MVP of this podcast. And she's also brilliant.
Well, thank you so much. By the end of the podcast, we're both kind of drunk and we just like fawn all over each other.
Oh, you're brilliant, Kristen.
What do you mean? What do you mean by the end of the broadcast? I thought it was happening a lot sooner than that.
No. The thing that I drank so much.
Well, this is our last episode. She was drunk when we started.
You know, there's somebody on Twitter who calls himself Drunk Austen, you know.
Oh yeah, I follow Drunk Austen.
So I think that we can talk about this now, and if we can't, she can edit it out. But she's made it Facebook official. So Kristen is actually moving very soon to Idaho, and her husband is already there. So Kristen has now been here kind of alone. So of course, whenever we get, she's already drunk. Because what else is she going to do, right?
Well, there you go. And I told her that when she's here, she's only a few hours drive from Portland, where we have a very active chapter of the Jane Austen Society of North America. But even though you won't be able to come, Maggie, but Kristen, you should go to the JASNA annual general meeting in late October in D.C., where they'll be talking about
the annual meeting is in D.C. and the focus, which is right by where we are recording this, and the focus is on Emma.
Yeah,
and I encourage everyone to go to the JASNA website, check it out. It's really interesting.
The Persuasions, the newsletter.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, despite the fact that the annual conference will be happening about 5 miles from where I live, I'm going to be out of the country, so I can't go. And I had these hopes that we could do a live podcast. Yeah, it would be amazing. So but it can't happen because I'm going to be in Japan. What?
With Faye.
And other friends.
That won't be too terrible.
Right. I'm really sad to miss it. Not really. So, Arnie, thank you so much for coming. We really appreciate you taking the time to chat with us. It was really fun. We have to do our typical end of the podcast wrap up. You don't mind bearing with us.
Yeah, bear with us, Arnie. First of all, mailbag, right?
Mailbag. Well, we didn't really get any questions, but we have shout outs.
But we do have shout outs. Thank you again to Ian. I have to think, we did a shout out to Mr. I in the last, Mr. J. in the last podcast, he said, it's okay if I say his name. So Ian, thank you very much. I will say that Ian, if you go to the YouTube channel, which is called First Impressions, the YouTube channel, he has left a lot of comments. I will say that he has challenged me very much in about the adaptations. I have revisited a number of adaptations because of his comment. I will say he has also told me that I need to rewatch Metropolitan, which is, of course, another Whit Stillman adaptation, because I will say I tried and I didn't get it. And I guess I wasn't smart enough. So I'll try again.
I just taped and I DVR'd and I'm going to watch The Last Days of Disco, which is with Kate Beckinsale and Chloe Savini. Right. So I'm curious to see what I think as well.
Arnie, I think you need to develop some kind of Kate Beckinsale Austen theory. That's because right. It seems like there's a lot. She's like the Kevin Bacon.
She's really smart, and you just have to see Love and Friendship. You'll be bowled over.
So, Kristen, we should do a movie night.
We should so do a movie night, and so also shout out to Jessica. Thank you for your email,
and Alicia again.
Thank you for your email. Alicia has actually said she's listened to this a certain episodes of our podcast more than once.
Can I make a confession,
please.
Kristen?
Go ahead.
Sometimes I listen to our episodes more than once because I just think we're funny. And I forget. Like we've been recording this podcast now since what, September?
Yep.
So
since July, right?
Yeah. Oh, that's true. So I will sometimes forget like the earlier episodes, and I go back, especially the one with Kevin, the Mansfield Park episode, with Kristen's husband, who is hilarious.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you for everyone who has emailed us. Thank you so much. We're so happy to hear from you. Oh my goodness.
Oh my God.
Arnie has a big poster that says Jane Austen wants you.
This was, I had this made for me when I was in Miami to try to solicit members for our chapter of JASNA there. So I just thought people would enjoy seeing it. So we want you to love Jane Austen, right?
And to listen to our podcast.
Everyone.
So thank you to everyone who's emailed us. It's so nice to hear from you that people that we don't know listen to it, because I really, as I say every episode, I thought it would just be our mothers. So it's really nice to hear from people. And Kristen will share our email address so you can email us if you haven't yet.
Our email address is firstimpressionspodcast@gmail.com. And you can use it with the periods or without, first.impressions.podcast or without, Gmail doesn't care. And please email us, and we love hearing from you. And please tell us where you are, because I have analytics about the podcast a little bit, but we have so many countries for different people, and there's one person in French Polynesia, which I want to say, like,
French Polynesia.
And if you do enjoy the podcast, feel free to email your friends and your fellow Janeites, because, you know, we're still an indie podcast. Artisanal podcast.
Artisanal podcast.
Whole grain podcast.
it I get really excited every time someone sends us an email. I don't know about, Kristen is the kind of webmaster for us, and she also edits everything and blah blah blah. She's amazing, and she'll forward me the emails and be like, "Oh my god, look who emailed!" I'm like, "Oh, we got an email! So exciting!" We get really excited. So even if you just want to send us your name and say hi, I'm from so and so. We'd love to hear from you. Send us questions. We'd love to answer any questions anybody has. We'd just love to hear from you in general.
That's right.
So we've talked about our wines.
Wine.
Plural.
Like since this is also on YouTube, I'll just take the bottle. Okay, the first wine we drank, we had two bottles, is an Albarino is the varietal. It's a 2013. It's from Homewood Winery. I actually bought it when I was out in California in wine country in Sonoma for my husband's stepbrother's wedding. Homewood Winery is a small winery. If you are ever in Sonoma, please look it up because it's amazing.
And so the second wine, which we haven't finished yet, but don't worry, gentle listeners, we will, is a Prosecco, and I love Prosecco, and I thought this was delightful. It is, where the hell is this from?
I don't even know if I can pronounce this.
Yeah, you know what? Here's a label. I'll just hold it up.
Prosecco, and it's like, hey,
it's good. I love Prosecco. It's not super dry like champagne tends to be, but it still has a little bit of the bubbles. So, do we have any other I just remembered. For our next episode, I'm trying to convince Kristen to let us record a commentary track for the 1996 Gwyneth Paltrow Emma movie, which you could then listen to while you're watching the movie, or just listen to if you know the movie and think was funny. And I think this would be so fun.
Yes, it would be so fun. If you know how to do that, email us.
No, I know how to do it. You just watch the movie here on this computer while we record
it. You know, like Emma, you know, and also Mystery Science Theater 3000, which if you know what that is, that's
Riff Tracks.
Riff Tracks. They probably have a tutorial. And I was also going to say what?
Kristen, don't drink an empty bottle.
It's empty.
Take from the one that actually still has wine in it.
Are you getting silhouettes of your heads watching the movie screen?
No, we're not. I don't think we're that technically that. We'll just kind of watch the movie and make ridiculous comments. And then people can, at home, they can hit start now and start the movie while they watch it, and they can listen to us.
I shouldn't drink this. It's going to be back watching it. I guess I was just going to say thank you to everybody. Thank you, Arnie. Thank you so much for doing this. We really appreciate it, and we really think you're brilliant, and we appreciate you coming to the podcast. Thank you, Maggie. Thank you, Bay, best boyfriend ever.
My dream for Bay is that this podcast becomes so popular that fangirls create a website never seen Bay.
he's the Jane Fairfax of this show. No question.
You're not pregnant, are you?
Yes. And
it's a food baby.
Maggie's about to cook me dinner.
So. Yeah, that's right. I am actually.
I guess I was just going to say also that Maggie listens to our podcast. I never listen to them again because I edit them. And I think by the end, I'm like, God, I'm so boring. Shut up, Kristen. Tired of listening to my voice. So thank you for everybody who actually thinks I'm interesting.
It's a small population.
All right. Okay.
Bye, everybody.
Oh, that was me.
All right, everybody.
Bye, Arnie. Thank you so much. And gentle listeners, we'll see you next time.
See you next time. Mm-hmm.